Good morning again. Welcome back to Stop Loss with Spencer. Today's topic is contract enhancements. Contract enhancements. Spencer, right? This is a general topic with seven subtopics or seven examples of provisions that you can layer onto a basic stop loss contract to improve the quality of that contract and make it distinguished against maybe some other options that you have. So these all could be theoretically layered on together. You could do one or a few, but these are options for you. These are, you know, arrows in your quiver. These are tools in your toolkit. These are crayons in your Crayola box, okay? Just they're options for you that you could put onto a contract to make it better, okay? So the first one, which kind of comes with the second one typically, so we'll talk about the first one and the second one, and then we'll talk about them together, but no new laser at renewal, okay? Very important, no new laser at renewal, all right? So what this does is it prohibits your stop loss carrier from adding new lasers at renewal time next year. Now that could be new lasers, that could be increasing existing layers. It does not prohibit them from placing lasers on the initial inception of the contract, okay? And one thing that I really want to point out that I know a lot of carriers would appreciate is these are not in perpetuity. Just because you have a no new laser contract and you renew with that carrier the following year, there is no obligation for them to continuously offer a no new laser forever. There's some business reasons like why. Typically it's because there's some enormous claims out there, but I just want to throw that out there. No new lasers, not in perpetuity. They're basically every single year you have to make sure that provision is still on your contract. So no new laser almost always comes with a rate cap, or at least a rate cap almost always comes with a no new laser, I should say. And so what a rate cap is that creates a maximum renewal increase that that carrier can place on your client at renewal time. And this is specific stop loss. This also assumes that everything else stays static, but this 50% rate cap is industry standard. I've seen 40s and 30s. I think I've seen a 20 before, but 50% is kind of that default. If you get a no new laser, you're probably going to get a rate cap of 50% on top of that. And it does sound like, geez, great, 50% cap. Thanks for being so generous. But on your smaller groups that maybe have a couple $100,000 of premium, maybe it's their first or second year self-funded, they don't have great cash flow, having the appreciation that my renewal won't go above 50%, that is a good thing, and that is something that could help smooth out or stabilize their funding if they're doing a 3 or 5 year strategy, okay? Experience refund. I mentioned this in a previous video. I, in my particular opinion, not a huge fan of these, but they could be perceived as an enhancement, and I want to explain why, a little bit how they work. I could do a separate video on these altogether if somebody would like to see that. But an experience refund is effectively saying, hey, if that self-funded employer has a good plan year, we will give them some of their premium back. And so here's an example of how one might work. If that employer has less than a 70% loss ratio, which is just basically claims divided by premium, right? So if I have, you know, for every dollar that's spent on premium, if I have less than 70 cents that go to claims, then I could qualify for a refund. So 70% loss ratio, the carrier will give you 50% of the surplus back. And in this example, they're capping it at a maximum of 10% premium to go back in your pocket. So there's a couple different caveats or criterion that have to be met. And if doing so, if the group has a good plan year, they can get some premium back. But again, they usually have to pay for it on the front end. So that's why I'm not a huge fan of this particular enhancement, but it is still one that is available. Plan mirroring. This one is vital, but it's difficult to quantify, right? Because there's not necessarily financial calculations attached to this, but plan mirroring is effectively the carrier saying, we will pay claims based on that self-funded employer's plan document, the underlying plan document. So even if, you know, perhaps there's some eligibility discrepancies in the way that their typical stop-loss policy would reimburse versus the plan document, That carrier will review the plan document, make sure there's not something egregious, and they will say, hey, we will mirror your plan document. We will pay claims based on that. That's effectively the Bible for that particular employer in terms of claims payment. So this is, I would say, this is one you definitely want to make sure is on a case, or at least ask your carriers if they even offer it. You know, that might make a big difference if you have some trusted carrier partners, but they're not giving you something like this. And you go, well, maybe I need to rethink whether or not I should place as much business with you, because this is, my understanding is this is a very important enhancement, especially when it comes to errors and omissions. Terminal liability. I waffled back and forth to whether or not I wanted to include it. It is technically an enhancement because it provides additional coverage, but most of the time, terminal liability is only really placed on a case when you know the group wants to go back fully insured or have the option to go back fully insured at some point or at renewal time. So what terminal liability will do is provide run out coverage on a contract that doesn't have a run out contract basis. If you go back to my contract basis video, this will be either placed on a 12-12 or a run-in policy to provide back-end coverage, again, in case that group wants to go back fully insured. Most of the time, go back fully insured. So yeah, it's an enhancement, but it's a very, you would use it strategically, and it's not necessarily to make the value of the contract better for this year, but it's to provide protection at the expiration of that contract. You could also lower the aggregate corridor. So my aggregate corridor video, I explained that 125% or a 25% buffer is the typical amount that's bolted onto the top of expected claims. Well, you could tell your carrier, or request of your carrier, say, hey, will you quote me a lower corridor? You'll pay a little bit more in aggregate premium, but it's pennies. And if they're willing to offer it, they'll give you maybe 120% corridor, 115% corridor. And so they're effectively stepping down the maximum liability that that employer would pay and increasing the likelihood that there could potentially be aggregate reimbursement. So I like this one. I like asking for 120. And it just sort of smooths out the experience over time. And again, assuming that the carrier is willing to do it, that it's not a really volatile case, this may be a good one that you ask for. The last one is advanced funding, and this comes into play again when we're talking about stop loss that's written by a third party carrier. We're not talking about the BUCAs doing the administration as well as the stop loss. This is if you carve out stop loss. Most carriers by default are building this into their policies nowadays. I typically see it given without even being requested, but advanced funding is sometimes called simultaneous reimbursement, sometimes called immediate reimbursement. Advanced funding, it's on the specific claims. It's for when a spec claim happens, you want to get that reimbursed quickly, right? You don't want to have 30, 60, 90 days where the employer basically pre-funds that claim waiting for reimbursement from the carrier. So advanced funding either creates a seamless funding experience, or if there's some eligibility proof that has to go back and forth and some dispute, assuming that all gets resolved, there'll just be a faster reimbursement timeline to get your money back as an employer who's paid those claims already. So advanced funding, again, comes in a lot of contracts nowadays. Just be on the lookout for it. But that's it. Contract enhancements. Let me know. Do you want me to expound upon one of these or a few of these? All of these have their pros and cons, and all of them typically have some sort of charge associated with them. But I would be on the lookout for these things, and especially when you're comparing options side by side, if somebody's got a really cheap quote but doesn't have any of those things in it, and then somebody has a little bit more expensive quote that has three or four of these things in it, then for me, I'm buying the slightly more expensive one that has a lot more enhancements to that contract. So that's it. Contract enhancements, 7 examples. Spencer, that's it. Bye. I don't know how to close this one out. See ya.